I always look forward to the Shabbos, and we have this list at Rabbi Orlofsky just for totally selfish reasons, because of our wonderful relationship, which very close relationship with Rabbi Orlofsky and I have for a long time. Rosh Hashanah. And I'm sure I'm sharing everybody's sentiments of the tremendous gifts that everybody's received from this wonderful Shabbos. I'd like to take an opportunity just very quickly to thank all the volunteers, Beth and Harry Green, Daniela Freeman, Simon Shanker, Debbie Magid, Goldie Hutler, Rafi Mavishev, Myron Eskowitz, Robert and Tila Freeman, Aaron Gross, Jeff and Gail Wysocki, and Joni Zuckerbrow Miller. And I'd especially like to thank for tonight the two chairwomen who put everything together. Mrs. Miriam Fain, I'd like to thank her very, very much. And also I'd like to thank my wife, Debbie, who's also co-chairing tonight. I'm sure everybody in the shul knows how much Debbie does, whether in front of the scenes or behind the scenes, for everything that happens in the shul, and we'd like to thank her very much. And also I'd like to thank the president of the shul, Danny Cromwell, who's standing by the door, and his mother's yahrzeit tonight, so it should be a skus for her and Shama. Everything that he and Miriam, the first lady, do for the shul and for the community, I'd like to thank them very much. And of course the sponsors, Mr. and Mrs. Fred Tachek, Krombox, Dr. and Mrs. Kurzman, and three anonymous donors, and we'd like to thank them very, very, very much. Again, this has been an incredible, unbelievable Shabbos, and we don't like to leave it just on Shabbos, so therefore again, I'd like to thank Mrs. Fain and my wife for putting together this wonderful Malave Malka. And I'd like to really take this opportunity, of course, to thank Rabbi Orlofsky for being Moser Nefesh. I remember a few years ago, we were sitting in here in the shul at Shal Shudas, and he said, "I really envy you." And I said, "Why?" So he said, "Because you don't have to travel all over and go all over the place, and you get to be in your shul, you get to be with your family." And we sometimes hear these wonderful speakers, but we have to realize that there's a family back in Israel. We'd like to thank Rabbi Orlofsky because Rabbi Orlofsky's flying all over the place. And that means being away from his family, being away from his home for Shabbos. So we'd like to take this opportunity to thank Rabbi Orlofsky and her family from afar. And without further ado, it's really an honor and pleasure to present Rabbi Orlofsky for the final show this time. The secret of the dreidel. We even have a prop for it. That's green because it's California.
Thank you so much. I think I'll take this out for a spin. Well, I want to welcome everybody who wasn't here for Shabbos and is joining us now. It's a pleasure and a privilege to be here in Anshe, Emes, as I said, throughout Shabbos, and all the people who really make this shul such a special place and such an unbelievable experience. And I say on a very personal note how honored and humbled I am by the people who come out to hear me speak. I live in Israel, where we have a large collection of retired rabbis who would be just thrilled to be able to have the opportunity that I have to be able to talk to so many people around the world, and particularly here in LA, and particularly people of such caliber. So it's not something I take lightly, and it's something that I appreciate tremendously. So I thank everybody for coming, because it doesn't matter how good you are as a speaker, if there's nobody there to listen, and you have not got much disappointment. So we've been speaking about Hanukkah, and we gave four different presentations on Hanukkah, and now we're going to give a fifth. Insight and ideas into Hanukkah. Because when the Yom Tov comes around, it's an opportunity for us to be able to look at it through a new way, to be able to do an insight into it. So I want to focus on a couple of different aspects. I'll start at the beginning. Where would a person go to get insight into Hanukkah? Where would we look for insight into Hanukkah? Okay, so I saw somebody had on their table over Shabbos the Art School Hanukkah book. But before we had that, you know, there was a time in Jewish history when where Judaism came without an overview, and we had to find our own way. Where would you look to get an understanding into Hanukkah? So, of course, there's the famous Gemara in Shabbos, but there's a probably a more obvious and more accessible place to get an insight into Hanukkah. And that is, of course, the Tefillah of Al Hanisim, which we say three times a day when we daven, and if you bench. I have to say that. I used to say when you daven and when you bench, and I have since been corrected. If you bench. Because I'm working on my doctoral thesis on problems that afflict the Orthodox Jew, psychological problems. The number one is called fleshophobia, which is the fear of becoming fleshless. I've noticed that German Jews suffer less from this. But for the most part, you know, you find that Jews get very, very nervous about, you know, becoming fleshless. Someone's like, oh, this soup's delicious. You want to taste it? No. I'll become fleshless. What if I want a coffee or ice cream? I don't think I can, you know? Where you people start counting, you know? Yeah, okay. Because after all, it's a six-hour commitment, you know? Then you wonder why there's such a problem with Jewish singles, you know what I mean? Six-hour commitment gets us nervous, you know what I mean? I taught a lot in seminary, so sometimes I'm speaking, you know, I'm invited from the girls' side, and I'm speaking at the bar, you know, and there's this young man there, you know, he's just got engaged, he's so happy, and I say, it's so beautiful, because marriage is forever. Forever and forever, and the sweat starts breaking out. So the number one is fleshophobia. Second one is benchophobia, which is the fear of having to bench. Yeah? Which is an amazing thing. It's relatively modern. My father, Aleph Shalom, would not sit down to eat without a piece of bread. My father-in-law would not sit down to eat without a piece of bread. I heard from Rabbi Peleg, who's the Rav of Shari Tzedek, that he once went to ask Rabbi Yoshev, what bracha do you make on a schnitzel? Now, in Eretz Yisrael, in the old days, a schnitzel was mostly breading. There was a little bit of chicken there, mostly breading. Yeah? You didn't have to worry so much about fleshophobia. You know, there wasn't that much meat there. You know, it was just enough to mess you. So he went to ask him, what bracha do you make on a schnitzel? So he says, what's a schnitzel? So he goes to the Rebbe and says, you never gave him a schnitzel? He says, tell him it's what he had for lunch. So he goes, he says, it's what the Rebbe had for lunch. He goes, oh, I never thought about it. You always wash. Who would just sit down and eat a schnitzel? I have the minig Shavuos night to eat milchik. That's how I grew up. I came to Eretz Yisrael. I got peer pressure. People were trying to bully me into switching. So I switched back to fleshers until Chaim Kreisworth, who was in at the schuss of having him in my building, so he said, what do you mean? We eat milchiks Shavuos night. And so does the stipler, you know? So I brought back our minik. So for Shabbos, we would, you know, for Shavuos night, we have lasagna and onion soup, you know, and all the milchik blintzes, the way, you know, the way my family, the way I grew up, you know? But for Shabbos lunch, you know, for Shavuos lunch, you know, I was making schnitzel. You know when the schnitzel first come out of the pan? I don't think about the little ones, like the little schnitzel. Yeah. So my daughter, she wasn't thinking. She popped it in her mouth. You know, I said, what are you doing? We're having milchiks tonight. You know, and she sat through the meal. My son made her a scrambled egg. And she cried. That's when she developed a fleshophobia. But today, when a person sits down at the table, you know, they say, do you want to wash? No. No, there's crackers, there's rice cakes, there's Mazonis bread, Mazonis rolls. I will never bench again. because it can take you almost 12 seconds the way most people bench. Certainly teenagers. You ever see a teenager bench? Can I go? You didn't bench, I'll do it again. Now part of this is because, you know, these kids have been singing the benching since they're four, and they're like traumatized already. Because yeah, it's not the most exciting tune in the world, you know? By the time they hit note there, they just gave up. No, they don't get up. Nobody wants to bench anymore, you know? So, benchophobia. So if you bench on Hanukkah, so then you will say Al Nisim. And Al Nisim more or less sums up the Hanukkah story for us. In the time of the Chashmonai. When the evil Greeks came. To get us to forget the Torah and take us away from your laws. And your great mercy. And we won. It was good for you. The Acha came, punchline. We came into the base midrash. We cleaned it up, we purified it. And we lit candles. And we established the 8 days of Hanukkah to praise and thanks, to give thanks to you. What's missing? Obviously. So someone says, well, the base of the light. No. We have the candles. What's missing? We have that right because they mentioned about the candles, the oil. The reason that we have donuts and latkes is because they're cooked in oil. And the reason that we eat foods cooked in oil is because, you know, the Greeks worshipped the human body and we want to show that we don't. So we're not going to have any Greek physiques. We're going to be nice, fat Jews the way God meant for us. So anyway, it's a modern thing. I grew up in America with latkes. We always had latkes, you know. Somebody asked me once in a question and answer, why is it the custom to eat, you know, eating foods cooked in oil, why potato latkes? I said, because in Eastern Europe, that's all they had. And on Pesach, they pretended it was a green vegetable for karpas, and they used it to fry in oil, and the rest of the time, they used it for furniture. And that was it, all they had were potatoes. That was it, you know? So, interestingly enough, the Chaya Adam wanted to outlaw potatoes in Pesach, because he says, since you can make kemach from it, you can make flour, that's one of the reasons kidneys, yeah. So obviously it doesn't apply to Svartans. Svartans eat kidneys, you know. I said to them once, I said, "You guys get to eat kidneys." They said, "Yeah, but then we have to say slichas for the whole month of Elul to make up for it. It's not really worth it, you know what I mean? Everything's a trade-off, you know. So like you don't have to weigh, you know. But now you know how to potato starch. They make pizza. They make pizza dough. They make hamburger buns. They make everything out of this. So because you can make flour, you want to asr it. So they said, in that case, change the name of your sefer from Chaya Adam to Chaya Potato, because the potato is going to live, but we're going to die because we have nothing else to eat but potatoes. You know, in Israel, you can see this a lot. All they eat are potatoes. I said this to Yerushalmi. I said, how do you get through a whole Pesach only eating potatoes and onions? And he said, onions. It's interesting, but in Israel they have sufganiyot, right? Which you call them donuts, which I think is pretty funny. Yeah, sufganiyot are actually what Angel's Bakery does is they save all of the challah rolls from the whole year and then they soak them in oil, yeah? So that if you stuck a wick in it, you could recreate the Hanukkah miracle right from that. You know, and then they put a little jelly inside and some powdered sugar on top. This way, everyone knows if you've had a sufganiyot, because the jelly will get on you, and if not, then the powdered sugar gets on you. And when you try to brush off powdered sugar, it just gives you a glaze. So everyone can look at your suit and realize, you know, yeah, he had a sufganiyot. So it's kind of hard to hide, you know. There was only one year when you they didn't have any powdered sugar on the Sufganiyot. That was the year that they were afraid of the anthrax. So they were afraid that someone would sprinkle anthrax on top of the Sufganiyot. But I think that the oil would have killed it, so I wouldn't have been too worried. But anyway. But now there is a reference then. Where's the dreidel? Nowhere does it say, and they play dreidel. And we know that the ubiquitous dreidel is one of the most important symbols of Hanukkah, and I say that knowing that most people don't have any idea what the word ubiquitous means. Yeah? It's a fancy way of saying all over the place. Yeah? The dreidel is everywhere. I was speaking to a group of students at Hebrew University who had a, you know, afternoon school education, Jewish education. I said, what did you remember from your Judaism? Dreidel, 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 I made you out of clay. It's deep, it's meaningful, it's spiritual. And that was it. That's all they remember is the dreidel. Yeah? And I have to tell you that this is such a happy moment for me right now. Because I have here an actual dreidel. I'll explain to you what I mean. For years, when I grew up, everyone knew that there's a gimel, a nun, a hey, and a shin. Neis gadol hayasham. I was in fourth grade. They used to hand out dreidels. And, you know, that's great because you get something for free and you don't have to learn, you know, you have to play. It's like the best time of year. And I get a dreidel and I say, Rebbe, it's defective. There's no shin. It has a pay. He says, this is a new and improved dreidel. It's neis gadol hayapo. I said, that's ridiculous. I want a real dreidel. You know what I mean? We're gonna... So the guy says to me, no. It makes sense. Because if you get a shin, what are you supposed to do? Pay. So the pay is really more appropriate to put on. This is one of many insignificant things that people bring to try to make significance. For example, you know, people on Thanksgiving, how do you say give thanks? Hodu. What is turkey in Hebrew? Hodu. Is the proof that you should celebrate Thanksgiving. Yeah. It's almost as good as if you made a gematria out of the ABC. A being 1, B being 2, C being 6. Okay? So God, G-O-D, would equal 26. The same as Yud-K-Vav-K. Means nothing, but there's no significance whatsoever. But it sounds cool, you know what I mean? Well, anyway, I just don't know why they had to switch my dreidel, and I'm really very upset about it to this day. And I really can't afford therapy, so I work my problems out in public. Anyway, but where's the dreidel? So, okay, you don't expect them to actually sit down and say that they play dreidel, but we know where the dreidel fits into the story. We all know that when the Greeks came, the Jews ran away to the mountains, they hid, and in the Greeks, they weren't allowed to learn Torah, so they were learning Torah, and if the Greeks came looking for them, they hid all of their scrolls, and they took out a dreidel, they pretended they were just running an illegal casino. That was okay, you know what I mean? They, you know, you pay the guy 20 drachmas and he goes on his way, you know? And then they go back to learning. I've been in yeshivas today where it's a little backwards, you know? The boys are sitting there playing, and when the Rebbe comes over, they pull out their gemaras and pretend they're learning, you know? So it's a little sad commentary. But nowhere do you get that impression here. If you read Al-Nisim, you don't see anybody hiding up in the mountains. You don't see anything taking place. The Greeks came. We fought them. We won. We claimed the base of Middash. We don't know what happened. That whole part of the story where they were hiding up in the mountains, that's missing. Where did that fit in? So we have to give a little background. We have to fill this out and flesh it out a little bit to figure out how this works. Right? The Greeks came to Israel under the guise of Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great was conquering the entire world, and he comes to Israel, and the Jews, being pragmatic at that time, said, okay, well, there's no way we're going to defeat, you know, Alexander the Great. In the 15 world battles, the 15 decisive world battles of world history, no, 15 decisive battles of world history, yeah, by Sir Edward Creasy. From Marathon to Waterloo. So he lists one of the battles of how Alexander defeated the Persian army. And he says, all of Alexander's army was not even as big as Darius's right wing. And it should have been a slaughter, but Alexander's army was so good that it just destroyed everything. So we knew we didn't stand a chance against them. So Shimon HaTzadik puts on the clothing of the Kohen Gadol, the Gemara Neuma describes, and he goes to surrender. And Alexander the Great gets off of his horse and bows down to him. And Shimon HaTzadik says, you must be new at this. When we surrender, we bow down to you. And he says, well, I'll tell you an interesting thing. Whenever I go off and fight my battles, somebody dressed in those clothing would come and tell me what to do, and that's how I was victorious. He says, in that case, you may rise. Yeah? And Alexander said, listen, I'm going to conquer the place, but I'm going to give you guys autonomy. I'm going to give you the opportunity to keep your religion, to keep everything, but we're going to take over the country. And when they took over the country, they introduced all of the best that Greek culture had to offer. Gymnasiums, and theaters, and universities, and everything that was Greek culture. And the Jews were enamored. And most of the Jews started to pull into it. And Dessler explains that when you start to be drawn into something and you go against, whatever a person wants to do, God will help you. Yeah? If you're on your way to do something bad, you're not going to get hit by lightning, your car is not going to break down, God's going to help you. You want to do good, God will help you. You want to do bad, God will help you. So you want to be assimilate, I'll help it along. And he sends Antiochus, who sends a rule, everybody has to become Greeks. And most of the people were okay with that. And those who were still true, the small group of fanatics, escaped up into the mountains and hid. And those are the ones who sat and learned and would bring out the dreidels and pretend. And wait. Now, you can't have a complaint against these people. What did you want them to do? What did you want them to do? You know? When you're fighting for your life, you're fighting for survival, you know? There are people who question the Jews in the Holocaust, you know? Why did they fight? Why did they run away, you know? I spoke to people. They said, and go where? Everybody hated us. The Poles would kill us just as quick. The Ukrainians would kill us just as quick. He says, and you had families, you had children, you had grandchildren, grandparents. Do you abandon the elderly and the young and just run for yourself, you know? There's no food. You're going to live out in the forest. It's freezing cold. What are you supposed to do? So here and there, people would dig a tunnel. They would try to steal food. They would try to this. But you're talking about millions of people. 3 million people. Where were they supposed to go? Nobody wanted to let them in. And even if they did, who had the money to get a ship? You know? They go and fight. What are we supposed to do? I mean, it's an amazing thing. You know? It's so easy for us to turn around and say, what would you do? What are you supposed to do? So this small group of Talmidei Chachamim, yeah, who are described as chaloshim, ma'atim, tahirim, tzadikim, oiskei sarasecha, this is not the making of a great military force. So they hid and they waited. Their main goal was to survive. That's what they wanted to do, right? You don't expect us to fight the Greeks. We don't have the power. We don't have nothing to do. And they hid up there for 3 years. The last mission in Sukkot tells the story how the Greeks entered the base of Mikdash. And a daughter, one of the houses of the Kohanim, takes out her shoe and bangs it on the Mizbeah. Calls it wolf. Wolf. Eat up the money of the Jewish people and you don't defend. And the Beis HaMikdash sits cold and dark. And pigs are being offered up on the altar. And what do you want us to do? What can we do? And after 3 years, a small group of Jews get together and say, Ad Kan, we cannot take this anymore. And they ask a shayla. Here's the shayla they ask. Are we allowed to go out and fight the Greeks? You think you're going to win? No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die. Yeah? I don't think that we stand a chance of winning. I want to die as Kiddush Hashem. I want the world to see there are still Jews who are willing to die for what they believe in. I know it is hopeless. I know it is suicide. But how can I sit here and watch the Torah being disgraced, the Beis Hamikdash being desecrated? Are you allowed to put yourself in a situation where you're going to give up your life? That was their question. And the answer they received is that this question had been asked years earlier. Nebuchadnezzar built a giant statue, and he said three people from every nation is going to be chosen, and they have to bow down to it, and if they don't bow down to it, they'll be thrown into a fiery furnace. Selected were the Jewish people, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And they went and asked Ashaila, what do we do? And Yecheskel said, I heard from my Rebbe Yirmiyahu, heard from his Rebbe Yishayo. When there's danger, run and hide. My advice to you is, get out of town fast, hide until this whole thing is over. And they said, Shkoyach, what if we don't want to run away? What if we want to not bow down and be thrown into the furnace and show that there are still Jews who are prepared to die for what they believe in? Are we allowed to, or is it suicide? And the psak they got was, you don't have to, but you're allowed to. And that's what the Rambam paskins la halacha. If you want to put yourself into a situation of dying as Kiddush Hashem, you are allowed to. It's not called suicide. So the Chashmonaim said, that's it, we're going to go off and fight and die. So they gathered together the troop, the few people. Yehuda Maccabee gives them a Musa Shmooze before they go out to battle. Yeah? And tells them, we're going to go off, we're going to die as Kiddush Hashem, purify your thoughts. Yeah? They went out betainus, because the army would fast when they would go out to fight. And they went out to fight. This must have cut quite an impressive figure. When we see pictures of the Maccabees today, we see these muscular guys with the spears. This was a bunch of yeshiva guys. Yeah? Not in the best of shape. Right? Running down the hill. Yeah? Moshe, which way do you hold the spear? Shkoyach, shkoyach. Yeah? And they're running towards the Greek. I'm sure the Greek platoon that they picked out must have been deeply impressed by this sight. You know, these small group of yeshiva guys running towards them going, "Hoy!" Yeah? And it was just amazing. Why would you even imagine that it's just nothing? And they turn and they fight, and they win. They defeat the Greeks. And they were very disappointed. Because here they were all psyched up to die as Kiddush Hashem, and they win. It's hard to tell what that's like, you know? This Brisker was attacked by an Arab terrorist, and he says, I'm going to kill you because you're a Jew. He goes, I'm going to die as Kiddush Hashem? Wait, I have to make a bracha. And he made it like a brisket. This Breslova was sitting on a plane next to a brisket. That's all I need to say. I don't know. That's not enough of a setup right there. And he goes, nah. And the brisket goes, shah. He goes, nah, nah. And he goes, shah. He goes, nah, 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 mo. He goes, shah. He says, nah, 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 mon. He goes, shah. He goes, nah, 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 mach, mach, mon, me, uman. He goes, shma. He was saying the shma. He wasn't actually shushing. It just takes him a very long time. Anyway, Baruch, anyway, I'll skip to the end of this because we could spend the entire year what's left just on this, the bracha, yeah? Yeah, Al Kiddush Hashem. So the Arab looks at him and says, I'm going to shoot you, I'm going to kill you, you make a blessing? Oh, you're insane, I'm not going to kill somebody who's nuts, you know? It's not, hey, and he goes, no. I'm very sorry, I don't know what happened. There is a concept called beginner's luck, that's the only thing I can imagine. But tomorrow I'll find a much bigger group of Greeks, and in Mirzah Hashem I'll get you all killed. So comes the next day, they fast again, he gets another smusser schmooze, they find a much larger encampment, and they go to attack. Bye! The Greeks are like, oh, this is ridiculous. And they go out there, and they win a second time. And they say, Yehuda, you're the worst general we've ever had. He says, look, I don't know. We must have provincial people here or something. I'm going to find a big army camp. We're going to attack that. You'll see tomorrow. You'll all be dead. Don't worry. So comes the third day again. They go and attack. And they win a third time. So Yehuda Maccabee says, Heir to Tzur Rabbi Yisai. Because like all great Jewish leaders, he spoke Yiddish. Yeah. He says, it looks like, I'm not sure, but it could be that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is going to give us a miraculous salvation and we're going to beat the Greeks. Says, what are you talking about? Nobody can beat the Greeks. He says, no, Zakhmir. You see, we beat three of them already, three groups. So I'm a Marashah. Either we'll all get killed like you want, or we'll win and liberate the, you know, the Jewish people and rededicate the Beis Hamikdash, but it's a win-win. You know what I mean? I don't see how we can go down. And so they fight battle after battle, and they win, and they win, and it doesn't make any sense, and I can imagine the Greeks were as surprised as anybody. And they win battle after battle after battle, and then they finally get to the Beis Hamikdash. They go to liberate the Beis Hamikdash. Scene change. I told you there's two places where you can find out what the foundation is of Hanukkah. One is, of course, Al Nisim, and the other one is the Gemara in Shabbos. The Gemara in Shabbos brings the following din, which I mentioned at Shalosh Shabbos. Yeah? Ner Hanukkah, what's the mitzvah? Ner Ishu Beisa. Everybody in the house lights one candle. Mahadrin? Everybody in the house lights one candle. Mahadrin, Mina Mahadrin? That's already, that's a machlekes. Beis Shammai says 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Beis Hillel says 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I am so confused. I don't know what's going on over here. I'm familiar with lechatchila and bediyeved. This is the best way to do it, but if you do it this way, it's kosher. I'm familiar with that. I'm familiar with hiddur mitzvah. You can buy an esrog, but you should buy a nicer esrog. Okay. What's called mahadrin? There's the mitzvah. There's mahadrin. And then there's mahadrin and mahadrin. What in the world is mahadrin and mahadrin? Where do you just find such a concept? Sears is going out of business, so I don't know how much longer I can use this joke, but Sears used to say, good, better, and best. Right? So you have kosher, more kosher, most kosher. There's no such a concept. There's kosher, and then b'di'evit or kosher like this. It doesn't say Nerish Beso is b'di'evit kosher. It says, that's the mitzvah. But if you want to do it, mahadrim is like this. You want to do it, mahadrim is like this. But what are these concepts? Amazing. Okay, back to our story. They come into the Beis Hamikdash, and the Beis Hamikdash is desecrated. The first avoda that they want to do is light the menorah. So the menorah has been stolen. They set up a temporary menorah, and Yehuda Maccabee says, "Find me tahor oil." I said, "Yehuda Maccabee, look at this place. There is no tahor oil. It's going to take us 8 days." To get tahor oil, right? Either because we're tamei, so it's going to take a week for us to get tahor and then a day to make the oil, or because the oil came from Gush Chalav, which was 4 days away. So 4 days to get there and 4 days to get there. It's going to take us 8 days to get oil. There is no tahor oil. And he says, find me tahor oil. So he says, didn't you ever hear the song? Yeah? Uparzu chamas, chamas migdalai, v'timu koshmanim. This was part of their battle plan to metame the oil. They wanted to metame the oil. It wasn't just stam, right? They broke down the walls, v'timu koshmanim. That was part of their plan, was to make all the oil tame. Say to the soldiers, Spartacus, Eradicus, Hepatitis, you know, let's go. Tame. General, I found a whole vat there. Stick your hand in. Tame. No metame all the oil. There's no tahor oil to be found. He says, find me tahor oil. He says, oh, man, this guy is so unreasonable. Fine. And they search, and they search, and they search, and they look over here and under here, and then one guy shows up and says, you're not going to believe this. I found one small container of oil, enough to last one day. And it's got the seal of the Kohen Gadol. So someone says, the Kohen Gadol doesn't seal oil. He says, well, I sealed this one, take a look. So that's unbelievable. So he said, now listen, Yehuda, it's going to take us 8 days to get oil. So don't be stupid. Put in an eighth of oil, and we'll light it, and it'll be enough. And that way it'll last us till we get more oil. And he says, put in the whole thing. He says, okay, you want it to burn the whole time? No problem, says the Beis HaLevi. Make thinner wicks. You don't need such thick wicks. Make thinner wicks. It'll use less oil, and then we'll have enough oil for 8 days. He says, fill it up and put in the regular wicks. And he says, but Yehuda Maccabee, what's going to be tomorrow? And he says, oh, all of a sudden you guys are practical. You had tainas on me because you didn't get killed right away. You went out to battle against the Greeks, which was a hopeless cause. And the only hope you could have was to die a martyr's death. You now defeated the world power. And now all of a sudden you want to be, when it comes to the performance of mitzvos, now you want to be practical. You got to make sense. Let's not be hasty. Let's take our chance. You put in the oil. And don't worry what's going to be tomorrow. Maybe your wish will come true and you'll die in the night. You know what I mean? You put that in and you light it. The says Rabbi Yitzchak Isaac Shear, the whole mace of Hanukkah didn't have to happen. Yehuda Maccabee forced the issue. And he forced God to either make a miracle or find me another hidden bottle of oil or something. But as he was prepared to go out and fight a war that he did not have to fight, and risk their lives when they didn't have to risk their lives, when it finally came to the performance of the mitzvah, he refused to compromise. You know why there's no dreidel in Al HaNisim? Because if there was a dreidel in Al HaNisim, then we would be celebrating the part of the story that would never have brought us Hanukkah. As long as we would have hid up in the mountains and played dreidel and waited for Antiochus to be replaced by a more reasonable king, wait for another power to come and defeat him, like we Jews always do, we're subject to world events and what's going to happen. We would have been saved, but we wouldn't have had a Hanukkah. Because Hanukkah is a holiday for fanatics, for people who are uncompromising and insist on the highest demand of Avodas Hashem. Otherwise, there's no Chanukah. That's why when the Gemara says, Mahadrin, 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 whoever finds Mahadrin, Mahadrin, it's not necessary. You're right. Everybody does it, though. Because Chanukah can only be celebrated Mahadrin, Mahadrin. Could you imagine you walked into a firm person's house on the fourth night of Hanukkah, there's one candle burning. And you say, how come there's only one candle? He says, why? It's kosher. It's kosher. Well, I have to do Mahadrin, Mahadrin. It's not a chumis. It's kosher. Kosher is kosher. It's good enough. Even the people who light the electric menorahs do it Mahadrin, Mahadrin. Every day they turn on another light bulb. Because there's no way to celebrate Hanukkah if you want to take it easy, if you want to be reasonable. Hanukkah is, I'm not saying I endorse his positions. I just thought it's interesting. There was a fellow with the Meir Kahana who, when he was murdered, as Kiddush Hashem, North Weinberg itself from Eishet Torah said, I didn't realize that he was on the level to die as Kiddush Hashem. He must have been much, much better than I realized. But he used to write an article in the Jewish press in New York. And he was responding to an article that was put out by the president of the JCRC, where he wished everybody a happy Hanukkah, the holiday of tolerance. And Megana writes, tolerance? The holiday began because Matas Yo killed a Jew who was eating treif. That's how it goes. He saw somebody pouring, he threw a spear at him and killed him, and that was the beginning of the rebellion. That's when he stood up and said, Mila Hashem Yalai. Tolerance? We fought Jews as much as we fought Greeks. It's a time for people to stand up. And the question on Hanukkah is the following. And to put it in these terms. How b'dievet a life do you want to live? When it comes to so many areas in our life, we are content to get by. Now, if we were the kind of people who were like that all the time, okay, I could understand. But we're not. Yeah? I went in to buy a hat in Brooklyn. There was a guy who was buying a hat. He came with two friends. He had been there already for 2 hours. After I left, he remained there for a much longer time. In the end, he never got a hat. Because each one was just not exactly what he was looking for. Yeah? And he says, can you shave this like a little bit, the brim, you know? Can you put in a different, you know, a ribbon? Can you change this? You know? It's not the hat. It's not perfect, right? I have 8 daughters. Thank you. One of the reasons I travel. Only chance I have of getting the bathroom to myself. Anyway. So, but when we have a simcha in our family, it's a tragedy. Because there is no one continent that has enough clothes for my children. You know what I mean? They're searching and they're looking here and they're looking there, you know. One of my daughters almost missed her sister's chuppah because after she got the dress, she decided it wasn't taken in the right way, and she ran back to the seamstress to have it brought in a little bit more. I think she was still able to breathe, you know, so put in a little bit more, you know. It's gonna be just the right outfit, you know, and it has to be just perfect. I don't know how many of you have ever remodeled. I bought an apartment on paper. We had to do the entire apartment, pick out everything. I don't think I've ever recovered either spiritually or psychologically from that experience. But you can see people who are like remodeling. You know, these women are carrying like little pieces of, you know, carpet in their purse, and they stop strangers and say, "Which do you think? Like, here's the wallpaper. What do you think? You know." Women, I have a tile here. And then, you know, they have one of those, you know, strips you get from the paint store of beige. It's like 5 beige. And they have like 300 of them, you know. Which beige do you think would go best with this one? And then they come in and then they paint it. They're looking at it. No, it's too yellow. Add this to that. Paint it again, you know. Put it in the furniture. No, I don't like it. Put it over here. Move it over there. Move everything around. And it's just perfect. Yeah. People have walked into the same pizza place 3-4 times a week to buy lunch. They have not changed the menu since 1974. Letters are missing, it's covered with grease, you know it by heart. And they come in for lunch and they're like, I don't know, do I want a calzone? Maybe I should, should I get a salad? And the first one was like, excuse me, you know, I want to order. He goes, hey, this is lunch. You know, it's not just anything. I want to have the right thing. I want to make sure I ordered the right thing. And at the end, you say to people, so how was lunch? Perfect. How did the room come out? Great. How's the outfit look? Excellent. How was your hat? Perfect. How's your life? Okay. How's your marriage? Not so bad. How's your relationship with your kids? Could be better. But look at my outfit. It's perfect. Because in so many areas of our life, we demand excellence. But for the most important things, we're prepared to have a b'dievet existence. It's okay. It's enough. It's not so bad. Why should we look at the most important things in our lives and say, you know, that's okay, I'm getting by. Why should I get by? Why shouldn't I live the best life I possibly can? Nes Gadol Hayapo. It's ridiculous. Yeah? The original dreidels they were playing with in Israel come back down to reality. I had a girl, Flatbush, very from family. She says, you understand, if I go home and tell my parents, this is after a year of my Mesil Shasharim, that every decision I make in life is going to be based only what's best for my Avodas Hashem, they will lock me up. You understand? She says, how am I supposed to work on, you know, spiritual growth? She says, tell them it's a skula for parnosa. Anything you know? I said, if that doesn't work, tell them it's a skula for shiduchim. That will for sure work. You know what I mean? They tell you to stand on one foot and cluck like a chicken, you know, and you'll get a shit up, people will do it. It's not a problem, you know? But it's like, you know, we, enough of the dreams. You have to be practical. You have to come down to earth. I had dreams when I was younger, and we lose those dreams because we have to be practical and we have to be real. When I started NCSY in Long Island, Rabbi Belitsky of the Youngsville Newark Park, he says to me, Bocher, you really think you're going to do this? And I said, yes. He says, Bocher, you know you're out of your mind? And I said, yes. He said, good, because nothing in this world has been accomplished by a sane person. You know? If you're not prepared to dream, if you're not prepared, the Panurit Rav took Yecheskel Sana out into the desert of Bnei Brak. Bnei Brak was a desert. He points, he says, you see that hill? I'm going to build a yeshiva. And over here, I'm going to have a Beis Yaakov. And there, I'm going to make an orphanage. And he sent a psychologist to talk to him because he thought he lost his mind during the war. Is he going to build all these things? Are you crazy? From where? From what? From how? A person has to be able to dream. A person has to be able to look shum. Not po. Don't tell me where you are po. Tell me you're going to be shum. I mentioned this earlier. Most people do what most people do because that's what most people do. And to actually think and to dream. I spoke for an organization in Queens, Chazak. And the fellow who founded it, he says, you know, he was just a regular guy, you know, and he says, I realized that everyone's talking about Mashiach, but nobody's doing anything about it. So I decided I'm going to, you know, build this organization and I'm going to bring Mashiach. And it sounded so funny, everyone just laughed. And he looked at them and he was so hurt and he said, I'm not kidding. And I was like, whoa, this guy's serious? He really thinks he's going to bring Mashiach? Yeah, he really believes it. He has dreams. He has aspirations. Where did we have? We had dreams when we were younger. We knew that we wanted to be somebody great, somebody unbelievable, and we give up at some point. When I was growing up, a guy who was 70 was an old man. He was walking with a cane, you know. That was it. He was an old man. That's why they had the retirement age of 65. You know, you retire at 65, you play golf for 5 years, you die, that's it, you know. Today, I see people in their 80s playing tennis. You meet people in their 90s. When I was growing up, whoever saw anybody in their 90s, you know? That means B'derech HaTeva, we're all going to live to about 100. And when did we stop dreaming? When did we give up? And when did we say it's good enough? And when did we stop going shum and we decided we're going to say po? When we light those candles and the shemen, which floats above the water, and you see the little flame flickering above it, not quite there, something somewhat intangible. And we look at that flame. And you know, when you turn a candle this way or that way, the flame always points up. Yeah? Nishama. The nair is a nishama sham. Yeah? So when you look at it, and you say, that's me. I'm this light that's trying to move up, that's trying to go shum. It's not quite po, it's shum. It's somewhere else. Most people live meaningless lives, not because they're better, just because they're easy. But when a person sits down to dream dreams, and a person says, what's the best that I can do? Dream dreams, forget about your limitations. Don't bother arguing your limitations. The Alter of the Vardic said, I never asked whether I could do something. I asked whether something had to be done, and I knew that HaKadosh Baruch Hu would give me the ability to do it. I'm going to sit down and do anything. There's nothing I can't do. Nothing I can't do. I have a famous story. I'm not going to tell it now. I'm sure I've told it in the past. But I told this story over about how simple, ordinary people can accomplish great things. And this woman calls me up. Well, I come and speak at her event in Beit Shemesh, a major fundraising event. And I said, for money, I'll do anything. So she says, I'll tell you why it's important for me that you come to speak. Because this organization was started by you. And I said, yeah, let me hear. She says, you gave that speech at how anybody can do something. Anyone can change the world. I decided, let me find something that no one's taking care of. And I realized there are poor cows. So people will help raise money for the wedding, and people will even help raise money for an apartment. But how are they supposed to live? She says, so I raised money, and I got a warehouse, and I stocked it with towels and sheets and bedding and pots and pans and dish towels and oven mitts, you know, and mixing bowls and everything that you need to outfit a, you know, an apartment. And we check out the condos, we find out if it's legit, and if they are, they come in and they just shop for their apartment. I went down to that evening and I said, I hope you appreciate that all of this is only because of me. And I've come down every year since, and now I am responsible for 1,000 poor callers having their entire apartments filled out. Because I did the only thing I know how to do, talk. I don't know how to do anything else. I can't actually do anything. But I have this, at least that much of a dream, that I can say something that is going to touch somebody's life, and they're going to say, you know what? I can do something too. I spoke at Project Inspire Shabbos in Flatbush, you know, a few weeks ago. And from people walk away from that inspired. And one guy spoke and he says, you know, I went and I found the bank manager was Jewish. I started bringing him challahs every week. I saw this one was Jewish. I started bringing him this. I started reaching out to people. Who says I can't do it? Who says I'm not able? There are a lot of people who live in this community who are looking for a shul. And they're looking for this shul. They just don't know it yet. Because no one's brought them in. So they go here and they go there and they do whatever. You will still be here tomorrow, but your dreams may not. Chanukah is a time for dreamers. Chanukah is a time for shum. Chanukah is a time for us to be able to look at those candles and see those flames burning above and beyond and say, that's me. That's my shame. My shame is a pasuk in Tanakh. My shame is shum in Shamayim. These are 8 very special days filled with tremendous power and holiness. The 25th word in the Torah is Or. 25th of Kislev. When they built the Mishkan, they finished building it on the 25th of Kislev. No one knew at the time what the significance was. But this power was built into creation, that these 8 days we can use it to dream our dreams and to reach beyond our limitations, to be able to become the people that we are meant to become, not Po Shum. Thank you very much.
Mashgiach Oberanovich, Zechatzal Gerocho, Rav Lipchinsky, points out that in a couple weeks of Parsha, we would learn about Moshe Rabbeinu becoming the leader of Klal Yisrael. And Hashem said, and Moshe Rabbeinu was concerned about his brother Aaron. So Hashem said, don't worry, that Aaron will be your spokesman. And the Mashgiach Abramovich says that was not just a prediction, it was a bracha. And from then on, Kohanim have the ability to speak to people. And so therefore, when you went to the Beis HaMikdash, you just didn't go there to slaughter an animal. You went to the Beis HaMikdash, and you brought a Korban, the Kohen would stop and say, you know, like, you know, he talk you through it. We call that today therapists. They would talk you through it. and he would have that ability to talk to you. And I've always noticed that in recent times, some of the people who we go to for Eitzah, the biggest people in our generation, unfortunately they're not with us anymore, were Kohanim. Rupam, my Rishi was Eichet Tzadik Bracha. And Yibadal Chaim, I know that my father, Rabbi Orlofsky, who's a Kohen, has also that ability. And we'd like to thank him very much for using that amazing ability to speak, to inspire us, to give us hope, to give us dreams. And Mirtz Hashem will all have that schluss to hear him again in Mirtz Hashem, whether it's in Eretz Yisrael or maybe here, hopefully in Eretz Yisrael, when we will join him with the B.S. Goel in Mirtz Hashem.
Amen.
And we invite everyone again, if you want to continue, Malave Malka, and thank you very much, Yashkov. We should all gather together for more Shiram.
Amen. Yashkov.